From a young rodeo cowboy riding bulls and wild broncs to scaling hills in Vietnam, Major General Robert B. Ostenberg, U.S. Army retired, has done exciting things. In his 37-year military career, he has served with honors and endeavored to lead his troops in both valor and safety in Vietnam and overseen their deployments in Iraq and Afghanistan. He's with us now to talk about some of the military life and about his time in Vietnam.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
So happy to have General Ostenberg here on the show today. General, I'm looking forward to learning things from your firsthand experiences. Thank you for coming to be on the show today.
Marilyn, it's a pleasure for me to be here today. I'm going to take this off so we can
get a good,
see you
good and, view of you.
Yes.
Well, did you have a boyhood dream of a military life for yourself?
Well, I had, my older brother got drafted, and he was in a year and a half before I was, and he served ultimately three tours in Vietnam. And I figured during college that it was hard enough to keep a deferment to stay in school if you didn't take the number of courses or whatever, so it was a matter of time. I had not officially received my draft notice, so I felt it was legal. But I heard that if you do that, you get to go to Fort Ord, California.
Well, what kind of training did you receive?
I went in and was sent to Fort Dix, New Jersey. And there I met quite a few very interesting young men, and we were in basic training, which is a real generalized training. But it was good basic training for military actions that you would need later on. My next stop was as an enlisted person was at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And we were going to be combat engineers. And a bunch of those same guys that I was with in basic training were there also. And oddly enough, quite a few of us were college graduates. But they kept working us on us there, and finally we bit. There were about, I think, 10 or 11 of us said, okay, we'll go through OCS. And we were combat engineers. So we thought that we'd go, you know, to combat engineer officer candidate school. That didn't work out quite that way. We were all selected and were sent to Fort Benning, Georgia as infantry. Infantry,
not nice.
To be officers for OCS, and that's 24 weeks of training, and it was great training, and really prepared us for anything we would have to do.
Do you want to tell us anything about that you had in there that maybe the public wouldn't think about?
The training started off with basic leadership, got some historical insights into famous leaders in the past, and. But it did take us through all the arms and working with other units of different types that would work with the infantry. And then toward the end, they had a real great exercise that was called combined arms. So we had tanks and we had artillery and we had big explosions and booms going off with things that they used as defensive positions. And so I looked at that and said, man, that really looks great. I mean, those tanks, they're riding around with all that firepower and everything. So at the end of the officer candidate school, I graduated high enough in the class that I got a choice to where I wanted to go. And I wanted to be on those tanks and be a cavalry officer.
When were you sent to Vietnam?
My company commander was a Medal of Honor awardee, Fred Ferguson, Captain Fred Ferguson, who was a hero in Hue, as Hue fell, as a helicopter pilot. And he was a great example and a great leader. And from that, I decided, you know, I can't stay here and do what I was doing there. I needed to get out and work with people and hopefully keep them safe and win some battles not lose too many. And I volunteered.
And where were you, what area were you in?
Well, I was up north in what we call I Corps and First Corps. And I started out in a fire base, Chulai, which is where the 1st, the 6th Infantry is.
Was it what you expected when you got over there? And did you feel prepared?
I because of the officer candidate school, I felt very prepared. The other commissioning systems are outstanding, but 6 months worth of straight duty with, and learning your trade as leaders, I think really helped me a great deal. It really did help me get ready. Now, what didn't help is some of the things that we did learn, because in Vietnam they weren't practiced. I was really good at making foxholes. You get two people to a foxhole and you make a circle at night, and everybody's, one person in each foxhole is awake and the other one's asleep, getting rested, and then they trade off, and you do that throughout the night looking for the enemy to come. And in Vietnam, we wouldn't stay stationary or dug in, so I never dug a foxhole over there as an infantry platoon leader on when we were on missions, nor did any of my people. A little scary on my first mission out, because I found out in the division that their standard operating procedure is to, you get into a night defensive position, you make a circle like a wagon train back in the old Western days, and there'd be an M60 machine gun pointing at a logical avenue of approach, and the other one would be on the other side, at another logical area of approach, and the circle would be there, but there would be only two people on each of those machine guns at night, and that's how you were protected.
Since you were highly involved with your troops, because I know you didn't just stand back and give orders, you had told me when we met a while back that you didn't want to ask them to do anything that you wouldn't do, and you ended up being point man.
Probably every fifth or sixth time we would go out, I would walk point, because I was asking them to walk point, and frankly, it was probably not a really good idea. But I had a platoon sergeant, very capable platoon sergeant. We kind of had a pecking order. So if I were killed, he's then the leader. If he were killed, one of the squad leaders, and I had four squad leaders, would take over. But really, I'm kind of the one that knew the whole plan, and I probably shouldn't have done as much as I did, but the fact is that I thought that I should, and it worked out fine, and in a couple of occasions worked out very well. So the platoon was never at 100% strength, which would be at 42 to 44 people. We were always under strain.
Why was that you had so few?
Well, we had usually in the 30s, because I had four squads. It should be 10 each, but I had a radio man and a medic that traveled with me, and then my platoon sergeant and me. But they were mostly in the 30s because of the rotations going in and out. You wouldn't have people because of sick call or for whatever reason, so you're never in the field really full strength. But in the field, when I talked about that defensive position, once we leave the base camp on helicopters and we're inserted into the jungles, and we were in the mountainous area, so from that point on, you sleep together, you eat together, everything is a group, and everybody relied upon each other to keep ourselves alert and protect us, and also, if we need be, to react with force and defeat the enemy.
You were talking about your camp circle with the machine gun on each end, and could you hear the enemy if they were coming? Could you hear them way off in the distance if they might be sneaking up on you at night?
The North Vietnamese were really well trained, and even those that were in the South that joined with them were good troops, and they were very quiet and very patient. We didn't talk about this, but the fire bases would be within range so they could fire artillery if we needed support. And on a couple bases, they were attacked, and every senior leader was killed. All the sergeants were killed. All the officers were killed. And it's because they could take, over a six-month period of time, for instance, and watch that base day after day after day. finding what the routine is, finding who lives where, looking to see mm-hmm. who has the authority, and then they would go up after several months of this, and they would start to breach the perimeter. They'd go into it and see what the perimeter was like, and on a fire base you have all this wire around it and booby traps and all those types of things. They were so patient, they would figure out where they all were and dismantle those. And when the final attack came on one in particular that I can recall, they blew up the wire, the concertina wire, and were inside there and killed every senior person and went out the other side and hardly lost anybody. So they knew how to be patient, get up there. Now, when we're only in a place overnight, we were hoping that we could hear that. Mm-hmm. And in most cases, you can, but you have to really be alert. You can't doze off. You can't, you can't drop your guard. But we didn't have a problem with anybody breaching our perimeter.
You were saying that sometimes they can go, take 30 minutes to go just a few yards because they were so quiet.
They could,
that
yes.
You could not hear a crunch or a twig break or anything.
That's true. And one evening at dusk, they brought one of the sappers that actually had infiltrated into one of the perimeters but was caught. And then he agreed to work with us as a kind of like the old Western days, the Kit Carson scouts were Indians. We had North Vietnamese that we had taken prisoner, and they agreed to work with us. This fella came in, and we could still, it was just dusk, so we could see, but we couldn't hear a thing. Not only that, but he cut through a chain-link fence, and you couldn't hear the clip, clip, clip. It was just the slow, patient, the way that he did it. And pretty soon he's sitting right in front of the grandstand.
You've got many interesting missions, but are there some that you could tell us about?
I was walking point one day, and I was we were told to meet up with my company commander, and he was with another platoon not too far away. And so I walked point that day. And about halfway there, down a rocky cliffy area, all of a sudden there's pebbles and things coming down, and it was like, whoa, what's going on here? Well, I started to scramble up after it. I had two people covering me, but that's the point guy gets to do that stuff. As I got close, and there was a trail that was going up to where they were, and for some reason, I just decided not to go up that trail. So we circled around to the backside where it was a cliffy area. So they're on a little plateau with a cliff going back the other way. And I was first in line, so I started climbing up. And I had my radio operator behind me and then two other fellows behind them watching. And I called in to the company commander and to the platoon leader that was up there. I could hear somebody hitting with a machete, sitting down, having a comfortable time. And I called in to tell them to let them know we're going to come through and gave them the direction and said to let the security know. And for some reason, they didn't have security out. I scrambled to the top and got three other guys up there with me, and we eliminated what could have been a disaster because we got some North Vietnamese coming in with the grenades ready to drop over a little ledge that would have gone down amongst those probably about 46 to 48 people, and they would have had heavy casualties. So we were able to avert that.
For the most part, you brought everybody back. Did you ever lose any people during that time that you were there?
I did. We were in an area that we were working quite heavily and hadn't hit a lot. We'd been down in the valleys. We'd been up on the crest, the hills, the high ground, and really hadn't run into too much, but there were quite a few signs there. As we were walking toward an area where we were going to make a camp that evening, something just didn't seem right. And it was the smell of something it smelled mildewy. And the jungle's got a lot of smells, but this was more like mildew uniform type of thing or something like that. So not knowing what we'd find, I just had directed the point guys to go almost 90 degrees to the left from the direction we were going toward. And went in about 20, 30 yards and we set up a perimeter. And I said, set up the perimeter. We'll have half the people watching and half the people are going to start looking. And we found an extremely large cache of equipment within just a few minutes. RPGs, grenades, mortars, ammunition, rifles, pistols, and then a cave along with that with lots of food and a lot of important information and booklets that showed another attack on one of our fire bases, or this was a forward base, and which proved to be very valuable. So during the period of time, I started out by tying a rope to one rack, a bamboo rack full of mortars. And so I pulled on it, tugged on it, and it didn't blow up. So I did take a couple, walked over and took some of the mortars out. It seemed okay, so I turned it over to some of the other enlisted to do that. And some others went to actually look at some other areas. It was during that time when a booby trap was hit by a couple of my men and killed one and wounded the other. And it was violent. I looked at it, there wasn't a mark on his body, but a small piece of shrapnel went through. We didn't wear protective. This is what we wore. Mm-hmm. And I had little booklets here that I would carry, and my mission text or booklets and things like that. But really we weren't wearing any protection for that. And that one thing, it killed him. And we weren't allowed to contact the family, but after a while I did write a note to the mother because I had heard that he had a rough time at home in a marriage situation, and he had volunteered to go back and get killed. And that was not the case. Mm-hmm. He was a good troop. He did exactly what he's supposed to do. We called him Happy for a reason. He was a great uplifter. He was very motivated. And he kept us all moving, and he kept us all straight and safe. So, very sad loss, as they all are.
Is this the books that you carried in your pocket that protected you?
I tried to get one of these. This is a 23rd Infantry Division AmeriCal wallet, the official collector's wallet. And I couldn't get one anywhere. And they said they were going to get more in, but I didn't hold my breath because they were about to go home again. So up in that cache that I was talking about, with all that equipment that we found, I found this wallet. And so it's something that I've carried with me. I'd have my code of conduct in it, have pictures. Every time I'd go out on a mission, I would flash this out of the helicopter, because this is the infantry, kind of get their spirits up. I carried a U.S. dollar, because you didn't see those over there at all, also, you know, pictures of my family. And it was a great find for me, because all the people that came in after me, they did get nothing, because they were not making them again. And this has become probably one of my best souvenirs.
Tell me about all your gear here. You've got your combat boots, and I see that you have one of your dog tags down in your shoe. What's the reason for that?
You know, I've carried them in my boots ever since. We wore those down there in case you parted with something and you needed to find out who it belonged to.
One on your neck and one on your shoe.
Correct. Well, I wear the normal, I still call them dog tags, identification tags, but dog tags. So I wore one in each boot, and then you wear them around your neck, and it gives your blood type and.
And what is the garter for? I guess
this,
you call them garters.
Well, they're leech straps is what I call them, because where we were in the mountains, there were these, they were leeches. And leeches in Nebraska are these slimy things that are in the ponds that when you get out, you have them all over you. Mm-hmm. And in Vietnam, they were more like little worms, but they could puff up after they would latch onto you for blood. And they kind of moved like this, you know, they would. Well, this was to keep them if they got in, because we were going through water a lot, and they get to here and at least stop.
And then, of course, your hat, that you had on earlier, you've got some of your hand grenade rings in it, I see.
Yeah.
I'm sure you threw many more than that.
We used them quite often, and it with this, again, I got my name in the airborne. It was just whatever anybody wanted to do with them, and some of them were, you know, they'd put big designs on the top, but most of the working ones were pretty much like this.
Now, you received some awards. You got the Purple Heart, and tell us about that.
Well, that's usually what you get when you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. And it was, I've got some shrapnel, and frankly, after I was thought I was taken care of and everything like that, but I was back in the field, and I just was losing my balance, and this was with the infantry. And I found out when I went back the next time, it was just a disorientation type thing. I still had one piece in my head, and they pulled that out. It was I've never had any problems at all with it.
Oh my goodness! So, and then you had another award for valor.
I had the bronze star for valor. They put a V on it, and then I had an oak leaf cluster. So that's two. So I had two bronze stars.
Well, looking back on the war now, do you think there are things that have been done to make it end sooner or to have been more effective?
Well, you know, I think that what we were doing over there, we were very efficient. From what I've read from reading North Vietnamese accounts, they were drawing a fine line on unable to support what was going on there and collapsing. So, we had been there enough, and I guess we didn't want to take military action because they did have some other thoughts. Excuse me. Right before we were leaving with a cavalry unit, we were getting ready to turn in our equipment, and there was a plan that I thought was a military plan that might have really worked, and there might have been casualties, but it would have probably changed the outcome of the war. And that was, instead of turning in everything, going with all the armored units of the South Vietnamese, along with the other units that we had in the area, and our cav unit, the first cav, and going by ship and going into Haiphong and basically cutting North Vietnam in half. Now, this is the plan that I was told. I'm hoping nobody made it up, because I thought it was pretty good. That meant that all the resources that were in the South fighting a war offensively would have to be brought back up north, and I think it would have been a bridge too far for them to move things that quickly, especially with the firepower and the things that you can bring in with the cavalry, like air support and those types of things. But instead, they mined Haiphong Harbor, and the rest is history. And you know, right now, speaking of history, this is the 50th anniversary just passed us, so the Department of Defense is actually recognizing what's going on and trying to make it a special time for those Vietnam veterans that came back, because some of them did not come back to a very nice, welcoming home.
No.
And that's weighed heavily on it. And I know that you mentioned Cupertino has a memorial down there. They're kind of looking at all wars, but they certainly have a memorial. San Jose, I was at that dedication months ago. That it is the Sons of San Jose. They lost, I think, 142 members, and it could be 242, mm-hmm. but they lost. The city paid a large price, and they've got a beautiful memorial for the Vietnam veterans, and trying to make those of us that are still around that have bad feelings for it, try and get, make peace with that. And my brother told me not to expect anything when I got home. I didn't expect anything, and I got exactly what I expected, nothing. And so it's, for me, it's just a change, another phase gone, and it worked out fine.
Well, you've been doing such wonderful things for the troops and the vets, making so many appearances and speeches, and you recently rode your motorcycle in Washington, D.C. in the Rolling Thunder. And I was wondering, since, so much of the protesting was done in San Francisco, and we're in the San Francisco Bay Area, and the Vietnamese vets were treated so badly, I think, our vets of today are treated better, regardless of whether some people were in favor of this war or not. But when you're out walking around in the public with your military attire, how are you received by, you know, the general public?
Well, it's certainly a lot better today. And I actually have a friend who, I kid him about it, but he was a protester back in the 60s. And I think so I told him one time, you know, Peter, I recognized you from back then, but his, for instance, now he could not be more supportive of the military. And so I think that's a phase that even those that were violently against it, maybe they still feel it was the wrong thing to do. But the change today is people can have that feeling today, but they can look beyond through the uniform and not see a particular administration, a particular whatever, and they see that they're human beings that are going over there, and so they do respect the military. You asked how do people feel today?
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about an incident that I had in San mm-hmm. Francisco. Mm-hmm. I was going up for an interview with the San Francisco Chronicle with Julian Guthrie, and she came out and met me on the street, and we were about a block away. She's going to guide me into the complex there. And I was in my my Class A uniform, which is the tie and the coat.
All the medals.
And was walking by a gentleman that was sitting down next to a lamppost. And I would have to say, if I took a guess, and I think it's accurate, he was homeless. And as he saw me approach, he slowly got up and stood as straight as he could up, and he gave me a salute.
Thank you so much for coming and telling us about your time in Vietnam and your observations and so forth.
Well, thank you very much. Maybe it'll be helpful to some that need to be welcomed home and for others that need to mm-hmm. hold a kind spot in their heart.
We're so happy you joined us for this special program, and we hope to see you again next time. Bye for now.
I landed in this country, 1 year of life to give. My only friend a weapon, my only prayer to live. I walked away from freedom and the life that I had known. I passed the weary faces of the others going home. Boony rats, scared but not alone. 300 days more or less that I'm going home.